So in brace structures, we are doing earlier discussed about this designs parameters. Now next part of your design parameters, types of load. First one is your earth pressure. If you see this earth pressure distribution diagram, if I draw three earth pressure lines, Kp, this is Kp gamma h line, and this is your earth pressure at rest gamma h line, this is your active earth pressure at rest active earth pressure gamma h line, and this is my wall and this is your ground surface. So generally what happen, so this will be your P1 in the strut, P2, then this is your P3, now if I write, if I draw the apparent earth pressure distribution diagram for particularly typical cases of breast excavation, generally the earth pressure distribution diagram, it lies, this is your pressure distribution diagram, apparent pressure distribution earth pressure diagram, it lies if you look at here, it lies between Kp to Kp line to K0 line, then it changes from K0 line to Ka line. Kp line is your passive earth pressure line, K0 is your earth pressure at rest line, and K is your active earth pressure line. So this earth pressure distribution, particularly in breast cut, it is varying between Kp to Ka line and Kp to K0 line and K0 to K line. Now what is your apparent earth pressure distribution diagram based on this, based on this apparent pressure distribution diagram? Pressure distribution diagram. Now if I draw a apparent pressure distribution diagram of kind of a sand as well as clay, so this is height h. Now if I draw it, so this will be zero point six h, and this is your 0.6 h, it looks very small one. Let us put it in this way so that it will be now this is your 0.6 h, and this is 0.2 h, this is 0.2 h, and this is your pressure P coming on the strut, coming on the strut. This diagram is your apparent pressure distribution diagram for sand. Now for loose sand, what is your apparent pressure distribution diagram? The loose sand apparent pressure distribution diagram will be, this is P, this value is your 0.8 h, and this is your 0.2 h, Now for clay, it is coming 0.25 H, and this is your 0.75 H, and this is clay, and this is also P. This is for loose sand. If you look at this apparent pressure distribution diagram, because there is no specific pressure distribution diagram for particularly best structure, as this earth pressure distribution diagram is varying from KP, that means passive line to earth pressure at rest, then earth pressure at rest to active line. So based on this variation of earth pressure, there are apparent pressure distribution diagram for, in general for sand, this is variation of apparent pressure distribution diagram. It is varying from 0.2 H at the top, then 0.6 H, then for loose sand 0.2 H and 0.8 H. For clay it will be varying from 0.25 to 0.75 H. It remains constant, the variation will be up to 0.25 H. So these apparent pressure distribution diagram has been derived from this earth pressure distribution diagram, and it has, why it is called apparent, this has taken as approximate, because this pressure distribution is not a constant, it is varying from KP line to K0 line and K0 line to KA line. Now based on the apparent earth pressure distribution diagram, what are the empirical equations for sand? For sand, PA is equal to 0.65 gamma H KA. For clay, PA is equal to K gamma H, and K is equal to 1 minus M 4 Cu by gamma H. So M value is varying between 0.4 to 1.0. For example, for Calcutta soil, depth of cutting 4 to 8 meter, M value is varying, for 0.6, and depth of cutting 8 to 12 meter, M value is varying 1.0. This is a typical example of Calcutta soil. From this apparent pressure distribution diagram, your PA value of sand is 0.65 gamma H into KA, K is your active earth pressure. For clay, PA is equal to K gamma H, K is equal to 1 minus M 4 Cu by gamma H, Cu is your undrained cohesion, M is a factor, it is varying from 0.4 to 1.0. So based on the different cities, different soils, this M value is varying. For example, for Calcutta soil of excavation 4 to 8 meter, M value is 0.6. For 8 to 12 meter, M value is equal to 1.0. So for strut load, this is about your earth pressure distribution diagram, and from their apparent pressure distribution diagram, what is the value of pressure coming in the strut, that is for sand, clay, this is all about. Then strut load, if this is my pressure distribution diagram, if I draw this is the pressure distribution diagram on the wall, so this is P1, this is your P2, this is your P3. How do you decide your strut load? Means what strut load you are going to consider for your design? Suppose this is my apparent pressure distribution diagram based on the one of the pressure distribution diagram for sand or loose sand or clay. So if this is the pressure distribution diagram on the wall, this is the wall. Now find it out maximum pressure where it is coming. maximum pressure where it is coming, or maximum pressure where it is coming, or maximum load where it is coming. Suppose this is a pressure distribution diagram. Suppose in this case P1 and P2 and P3, suppose maximum load is coming about P2, that means this strut load. Suppose P1 is a strut load, P2 is a strut load, P3 is a strut load, that means maximum strut load is coming about P2. This has to be considered for design. That means from pressure distribution diagram, maximum strut load has to be considered for your design. Now, once this part of your earth pressure distribution diagram is over, then from there if you find it out pressure, from there you will find it out your load on the strut, then from this load on the strut, maximum load on the strut, means the design has to be done, maximum load on the strut. Now, what are the effects on the brace cut or major concern? Before we solve one example, so what are the major concern on the brace cut or major effect? Major effects of brace cut. So, part 1 is your ground settlement. If you look at this, this is a wall and there are struts. So, as I said, there will be a bottom heave, say this is your volume V2, and there is also a lateral movement. This is called total volume V. Because of your ground settlement, so this volume change is your V1, and this is your delta maximum. Now, volume of ground V, volume of ground, how much is your volume of ground? It is your V1 plus V2, and L is your zone of influence. L is your zone of influence. Zone of influence. How do you calculate lateral movement? Lateral movement will be, lateral settlement, lateral movement will be calculated from your rigidity of your structure. If how rigid is your wall? Look at here. How rigid of your wall at here in this position, also how rigid of your wall in this position. So, what happens when there is a ground settlement occur? This, if this wall is not rigid, this will be deflected. If this will be deflected, there is a change in volume. There is a change in volume. This is called V1. Because of V1, because of lateral displacement of your wall. It depends upon your rigidity. And V2 is your because of your heave. Once it displaces, there is a chance the soil will be go inside, so there will be heave. So, total ground settlement, if I say total V, what is the volume? That means V1 plus V2. And what is L? So, it will displace, ground settlement will occur, it will go somewhere else, it will merge. That means, up to this distance, there will be a zone of influence. This length L has to be calculated first, because unless otherwise if you do not know zone of influence, then how do you calculate in within that zone whether there will be any ground settlement or not. So, these both the parameters, V, volume as well as how much your delta maximum, it has been calculated based on your rigidity of your structure. So, there are empirical procedures. Empirical procedure given by Peck, how to calculate your particularly rigidity of this. If I write this empirical procedures here about your ground settlement. So, this is your empirical relation. Empirical procedure given by PEC 1969. So in this case, PEC 1969, if you look at here, this is distance . This parameter is your distance from excavation divided by depth of excavation. Now, if I draw, this is my wall, this is the wall, that means what does it, this parameter? This parameter is saying distance from excavation, as I said earlier, zone of influence, distance from excavation, this is your L, and depth of excavation. From this depth of excavation, that means where the ground settlement occurs, this is your distance from excavation to depth of excavation. It has been expressed in dimensionless form so that it can be used for anywhere else it can be used. So, this value is varying from 1, 2, 3, then 4, then settlement, then next dimensionless parameter is your settlement by height in terms of percentage. So, this will be 1.0 and this will be 2.0. What does it mean? How much settlement occurs, how much ground settlement divided by total height h, divided by total depth of excavation h. Suppose this is your settlement occurs, that means this settlement is say delta. So, this will be delta by h, this will be delta by h, and in terms of percentage 1%, 2% and 3%. Both x as well as y axis, this has been given in dimensionless form. These are all your empirical relations given by PEC 1969 for different soils. If I draw it, so this is your zone of influence 1, means zone 1, then this is your zone 2, this is your zone 3. Now, what does it mean? If I am drawing it, zone 1 means sand and medium or hard clay. Then 2 is your soft clay. Of limited depth below excavation. Then zone 3 or 3 is equal to significant depth below excavation, These are the observation he has observed based on your seed pile, and most of the Calcutta soil, if you look at here, for example, most of the Calcutta soil is soft clay followed by a steep clay, and it falls under zone 2. Most of the Calcutta soil falls under the zone 2. That means zone of influence will be, if it is in zone 2 for Calcutta soil, zone of influence is equal to zone of influence or L is equal to zone of influence is equal to 3 times width of cut. If you look at here, it is going towards your 3 times. So, that means distance from x observation is your zone of influence is equal to 3 into your width of the cut, that means depth of x observation. So, it will be 3 times. Now, based on this chart, first what you are supposed to do? Based on the chart, first you identify what is your soil, profile in the x observation, then make a call. If it is a sand or medium or hard clay, for sand it is varying from 1 to 2, maximum value is varying from 2, that means zone of influence L you can find it out 2 times into width of your cut. Then for zone 2 it is varying up to 3, so that means maximum value is your 3 into width of cut. For zone 3 it is varying more than 4, from there you can find it out your influence zone, also you can find it out how much your settlement. The settlement by H in percentage for zone 1 is your 1%, zone 2 is your 1% to 2%, and zone 3 is your from 2% onwards it is varying. Suppose it is a zone 2, that means settlement is equal to 1% of total H, that means H is equal to total depth is equal to 5, that means 5 into 1%, so that means 5 mm, so 1 by 100 is 5 mm, 0.05 mm. So that means with this empirical procedure, there are two parameters you can find it out. One is your zone of influence, other is your within that zone of influence, what is your maximum settlement or maximum ground movement you can expect. Now, this is one of the design parameter before you start, because this will influence your completely ground displacement and the ground movement, zone of the ground movement and maximum settlement. It will also affect your total pressure distribution diagram. This has to be found out from the beginning. Then next part is your, what are the factors for your ground settlement. Factors for ground settlement or factors influence the ground settlement. If I start with this first one, obvious, it is your subsoil characteristics, or you can write it out subsoil. Then it depends on shape and depth of excavation. Then type and stiffness of strut, then method of excavation, that means method of excavation means by means of mechanical or by means of manual, then time. Means these are the factors generally affect your ground settlement. If you look at here, as I discussed, by means of Peck given 1979 the chart, what is your subsoil profile? If subsoil profile is your sand, means the ground settlement will be less, but if it is varying from soft clay, then it is coming zone 2 or zone 3, then ground settlement as well as zone of influence it will be more. Then what kind of shape and depth of excavation? What is your shape? What is your depth? Are you going for a longer depth or deep depth or shallow depth? This basically influence your ground settlement. For example, shape and depth, what kind of, what is the width? How much excavation you want? What width you are doing? Is like this is one type of excavation, or you can do one is your small width, then you can find it out your excavation, you can go for excavation. Now, what is your H value? What is your depth? Are you going for a deep excavation or shallow excavation? If deep or shallow, are you going for what is your width B of this excavation? This is very small or large, it depends upon shape and depth of excavation. Then next one is your type and stiffness of strut. Means suppose I am applying here, this is my wall. For example, this is the wall, maybe diaphragm wall or seat pile walls. Now at regular interval you are providing strut. These are all your, you can say that struts. Now once you provide these struts, means what is the types of struts? Are you providing by wooden strut, or are you providing steel strut, or are you providing any, what is the rigidity, means what kind of strut you are providing? Based on this strut you are providing, what is the stiffness? Means once there is a ground movement, this strut, what will happen, this initially this strut will resist lateral movement of your wall. That means if this wall is supposed to displace, laterally displace in this way, what will happen, this strut will keep this wall in intact. That means it won't allow the lateral displacement of your strut. So if it is not going to allow, it depends upon its stiffness, what kind of strut you are providing, means steel, wooden, aluminium or very rigid strut. As the more the rigid, the strut will be more the rigid, there is a less chance of your lateral displacement of your wall. More the means the, it again it depends upon your economy. Also once you are providing the rigid strut, the cost will be high. So depending upon that strut, particularly stiffness and type, this lateral movement also of the ground can be reduced. So next, fourth part is also another factor which is important. Method of excavation, how you are excavating, how you are excavating, means method of excavation means are you doing mechanically or manually. In India generally what happened, this manpower is very cheap, people go for manually. The moment you go for method of excavation by means of manually, that means by manual labor, by layer you are going, what will happen, it takes time. Manually once you reach here, by that time what will happen, this wall has been already displaced laterally, because it takes time and chances of ground movement is high. But if you are doing mechanically, you can finish within the time. So that before placing, what will happen, once you are doing manually, once you start excavation and start your placing your wall, before providing your strut, this wall already started lateral displacement. That means it is because of manually. But if you do it by mechanical method, so what happened, their chances of ground movement will be very less. Then another one is your time, construction time, means particularly how your construction time, more you take construction time, more chances of lateral excavation will be more, or ground movement will be more. So as soon as possible you should finish this construction process, so that ground displacement or ground movement can be avoided from this. So once again, this summarizing, this is because one of the major factor, ground settlement is your major factor for design. For doing this ground settlement, you need to have two parameter, as I discussed earlier. One is your zone of influence, other is your settlement or ground movement. Once you know the zone of influence and as well as ground movement, suppose this is my zone of influence, this is your zone of influence and this is your maximum displacement of ground displacement. Once you know, you can decide whether there is any structure, whether already there is any construction, whether there is already any existing building. So what happened, generally this underground construction has been done particularly in metro areas. You have to take consideration of your what kind of building, what kind of structure is already there in zone of influence. Once you know the zone of influence, you would then, based on your zone of influence and delta maximum, your stiffness has to be decided. It is either way. Suppose before design you find that delta maximum is equal to 10 mm, and zone of influence, suppose this is equal to say kind of 0.5 meter or 0.3 meter. So, within this zone of influence, suppose say there are multi-story building already existed. So, that means before doing this construction starts, you should be sure that there should not be this kind of delta maximum, there should not be a zone of influence. So, to protect this ground movement further, what will happen? You provide your stiff struts so that it will not allow further this, there is a lateral displacement of your wall. So, it is either way, because this ground settlement has one of the major parameter, this has to be taken consideration before starting of your design. So, maybe I will stop here. Next class I will start a complete design, how to solve a problem taking into consideration of ground settlement. Thank you.